were like, they made the music for the war, is what I'm trying to get at. So because the entire nation mobilized its entire resources, including music, like that's the main point here. Music was definitely influential when it came to boosting the war. So I know you've heard this a million times, and bear with me, I'm just gonna say it one more time. It's an important point, but the brain treats music like any other pleasure stimulus, and there's no specific part of the brain that's been targeted as the music part. When I was doing my research, of course, all those other books and psych studies that anyone else has come up with, music has stimuli in many different parts of the brain, and it's relevant to the topic because the emotional attraction to the patriotism and the hope and the nationalism that everyone feels when it comes to war played a role in encouraging the popularity of the music. So when you hear a song that you like, there's the amygdala somewhere in the back of your brain, that's the emotional center, and there's release of dopamine and serotonin to boost happiness and pleasure. And next thing you know, you can become attracted to a type of music without even knowing it. So that's important. The music of the time, at the time of the World War II, music was, America is just coming out of the greatest emotional and economic and everything you can imagine depression. Production was down, hopes were down, Americans were just down. But the music was still trying to, you know, boost spirits, and it was still major keys and peppy, and so it wasn't really too hard to transition for them from boosting the morale in terms of things are going to get better, we're America, we can come over this, to we're America, we can go fight a war, we got this. Popular music included like the crooner stage and big band swing groups like Frank Sinatra and Bing Crosby. But the operas and philharmonics were really popular too. As part of my research, I tried to find a bunch of reviews of performing artists. And a lot of the reviews that I found were Philadelphia Philharmonic and New York Philharmonic performing X Symphony or X Concerto, and wow, this is still going on. But most of the time with that kind of music, middle class families weren't really into that. Not because they didn't like it, but because they couldn't really afford to go, because philharmonics are kind of expensive. Especially in a depression. So artists took it to another level in terms of the uplifting, and they needed to directly mention the war. So I would like to introduce you guys to a favorite of my grandmother's. She was born at the end of World War II era, and when I was talking to her on the phone about this, she was like, oh my gosh, they were so awesome. This little singing group was composed of three sisters, Laverne, Maxine, and Patty, and they are from Minnesota. They were born in the early 1900s, like the 19-teens, and they started like their whole singing trio when they were younger, you know, around the piano. Mom would start playing, and they'd pick it in, and they ended up with this awesome harmony sound that you're going to hear later, but it became really popular because of the consonants in someone's ear, which, again, the dopamine and the pleasure. They became popular because they performed a lot. They were on, I can't remember the guy's name, but he had them on tour for a while, and then they left. But then they ended up producing, it's called By Nervous Duchenne, and I'll show that to you later too. And they produced that, and that was their first hit, and then they started producing more wartime music. So that happened in the 1940s, and they were performing until, really solidly, until 1968. And they were really such a big part of the World War II's emotional arson, I guess I want to call it. So we will start by looking at their music. And this is one of my personal favorites, called The Boogie Woogie Bugle Boy. This is one of their songs that is directly about the war, and that's something that you haven't really seen up until now. It speaks of a young man who gets drafted, and he wants to play music, and he can't play music, but then he ends up being like the bugle boy, calling the different signals for the troops to do different things. So it puts an uplifting twist on a way that the positive emotions of the country and the fast tempo, you know, the whole deal with your tempo being faster than your heart rate, get you excited. That was definitely in play there too, even though it was subconsciously, because I'm not entirely sure if they discovered that from yet. The syncopation and the timbre of the instruments gave it a swing feeling to it. And the clearly defined structure with the verse and the verse reflects the music of the time because it was still very structured. There wasn't much reverse going on. The next song that this type of songs that I looked at dealt with having someone off fighting the war. Now, if you can picture that you're like the housewife of the home, sorry guys, and your beloved is off in who knows where doing who knows what, and you've got the home, the kids, the country, because you've probably been wrapped into some sort of victory garden or lead campaign to help the war. And there's not much to you that can help you be happy, because while you're trying your best to help the war, it's a war. Like, you're not going to be excited about that. So the songs about people who are off fighting were kind of had a very sentimental tone to it. The first popular song by Dear Mr. Jing is kind of an international love song. In case you didn't notice, the title is German, and it pretty much means that you're beautiful to me. It talks about how much people mean to each other, and the next song, too, is called Don't Sit Under the Apple Tree. I want to put the whole thing down, clog up the slide. It's another love song, but it's about the war. So it, again, shows how the war is bringing music into its capacity, and people are starting to go from just a plain old love song to incorporating the aspect of having someone away. In that one, a soldier asks his lover to wait for him. I'm getting ahead of myself. So, this is by Dear Mr. Shin. Encourages sexually.
the guys from the Three Stooges? The man that walked out with them? He looked like him. Go before.
Yeah, that might have been.
Go before. When he has a frontal. I mean, it looks like him.
Possibility. Okay.
Sorry.
Yeah, comedy. There we go.
You have some comments.
Huh?
You have some comments.
Ooh, I'll do that later. I'll send you an email. Okay. I think that the reason that they had very sparse instruments is because then the audience can focus on the lyrics. And they can definitely get, like, it focuses on how the separation of having someone away, but then it ends with the "till I come marching home," so it kind of slips in there that positive thinking that your sisters were known for. And then the last kind of song that they performed was to get your mind off of the war. So instead of talking about love, instead of talking about the war itself and the beauty of the war, these kind of songs were meant to relieve stress and take someone's mind off the war. Because while some songs wanted to promote the war, other songs, you just need a break from it if it's all around your life all the time. So the first one, called Rum and Coca-Cola, basically makes the reader think of a warm paradise and a cold drink, because sometimes that's all those people need. It's very, very distinct the second the first note comes that you are not thinking about marriage.
Just a little bit of this, it's time to wrap it up.
Morale of the country. I'm going to go a little faster, you guys. memorizing a piece of music to practice. Citizens and civilians and military participants alike were involved in the music process. And by focusing on something like that that's productive and that takes a lot of your brain capacity, as the psych and music presentation showed, it can take your mind off the war. And in addition to that, one of the most important things was how it promoted the inter-community unity, because it gives, like, when you're working together on a collaboration like that, it is definitely another type of morale boost. So, in conclusion, if you want the slides, I'll give it to you. World War II initiated a change in American music because of the way that the music became from, changed from being upbeat to being upbeat and helping with the war. Music had a happy tone and spoke of love and the war and staying positive, like the Andrew Sister showed, and people participated in any way they could to support the war effort, including musical launches. So I guess this last slide applies to all presentations today. Do you have any questions?
Thank you very much.